Should we go to Mars? Yes. Thank you. 1 year ago today, I was actually on my way to Mars. Not the Mars you're thinking of. I was on my way to the high altitude desert of Utah, to the Mars Desert Research Station. The Mars Desert Research Station is a facility dedicated to astronauts on Mars simulation studies. And as the crew commander, I was in charge of a group of six other engineers and scientists. And we conducted about 24 experiments during our two-week stay there. Everything from psychological studies to protocol studies, hardware testing, rover field testing, transforming soil into rocket fuel, a whole range of things. But why were we doing this? Of course, to push forward our knowledge, to increase our preparedness for a manned mission to Mars, the first manned mission to Mars. But why? Surely there's more to it than it just being really cool. Now, don't get me wrong, cool is cool. The Apollo program, set on getting a man to the moon, inspired a generation. The number of students from high school through to Ph.D. in the subjects of mathematics, engineering, the sciences, the number of students doubled over the Apollo era. Now, doubling the scientific literacy of your population when you're living in a world so dependent on science and technology was a very good move. And it launched the U.S. into what it is today. What do we have to inspire the coming generation? So a few years ago, I came to a realization whilst studying my PhD in green morphing technologies in the aerospace sector. And it's a realization that's quite obvious. That is that the world we live on is finite. The resources we share on it are limited. My existential angst as a teenager had returned. Now, if we have no intention of leaving this nest, this cradle that we're on, we are in effect each other's enemies, fighting over the remaining resources that exist on the Earth. And as Jacob Bronowski once said, war, organized war is not some human instinct or break away from rationality. It is a highly planned and cooperative form of theft. Now, we are unique in that we are a shaper of the landscape. We are not locked to it like the rest of the animals. We engineer the world around us to our liking. If we did not, we would still be in South Central Africa, tropical creatures over there. But that's not the case. Take away our inventions and innovations, the use of fire, clothing, agriculture. How quickly will the world's population drop? Especially in the northern latitudes. So we engineer the world to our liking, and there's a problem with that. And that is that the Earth is a highly balanced system. Anything we do to it subtracts from that balance, almost like the law of entropy. So this is the problem we face. If we remain locked to the planet, we will eventually collapse. Pushing forward green technologies, bringing in strict regulations, policing the way we use our resources will slow that collapse, but don't be fooled into believing it as a solution. They're just speed bumps. We will eventually collapse. So here we are, faced with this critical problem, a branch point in human history. Do we remain on Earth, or do we spread? An additional layer to this is that we need to protect ourselves and the life around us. So this is the problem. I think Mars is the next logical step for humanity, not the moon. The moon to Mars is what Greenland was to North America in the previous age of exploration. The moon simply does not have the resources required to sustain a technological civilization. Mars does. Take plant life, for example. Mars has fertile soil. It has a carbon dioxide-rich atmosphere. It has an abundance of water. And it's got a 24-and-a-half-hour day. The moon? It doesn't really have an atmosphere. It has water as abundant as gold is on Earth. It's got a 708-hour-long day. The moon is simply not feasible for plant life. On Mars, it is. Now cold and dry, Mars was once a warm and wet planet, about 3 billion years ago. What happened was Mars slowly lost its atmosphere, primarily due to solar wind. The core of Mars cooled down and it lost its magnetic field, a magnetic field that protects the atmosphere from solar wind shedding the air away. And the thing is, with a relatively small push from humanity, we could take Mars back to its previous age in its warm and wet climate with a relatively small push. What we would need to do is increase the temperature at the South Pole by a few degrees. Doing so would enable a self-sustained global warming, and we know how to do global warming. Once the atmosphere has increased in temperature by a few degrees at the South Pole, carbon dioxide that's frozen into the soil would begin to gasify. This gasification process, carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, would further increase the temperature of the atmosphere. So we'd have a self-sustained global warming. Eventually, water, also frozen into the soil of Mars, would begin to liquefy, covering nearly half the planet. Once we kickstart this process, the transformation of Mars would take on the order of about a century. That's not a long time. Mars would settle down with an atmosphere of equivalent density to the lowland Himalayas and with a temperature good enough for a t-shirt and shorts. Sure, the atmosphere wouldn't be breathable, it will still be heavily carbon dioxide based, but we could introduce plant life to Mars. But then, let's say this does happen. When we eventually get to Mars and we've transformed it, who says our progress in technology and bioengineering won't make us more adept to the environment there? One of the major questions regarding Mars is, has there ever been a genesis of life there? So what I'm talking about is, has Mars ever itself had an origin of life? We know there's life on Mars already. We stopped decontaminating our spacecraft a couple of decades ago, and we know that there are microbes, Earth microbes, on Mars inside of the spacecraft hardware. But has life ever originated on Mars? Mars had the requisite conditions for life for about five times as long as it took for life to occur on Earth. That's a really interesting question, and would bring forward our human understanding of the world around us. It'd be a really big thing for the history books. But what about ethics? If there is life on Mars, even if it's microbial, do we have a right to go there? It's quite a strange argument, I find, but it's one that's been gaining weight over the last few years. I don't really understand it, because every time we wash our hands, we commit microbial genocide. We engineer and farm the complex life around us in as systematic and cheap a way as possible. I mean, most of you eat complex life that was breathing and thinking a few days ago on a daily basis and don't really give it a second thought. Why all of a sudden Would microbial life on Mars be given such sanctity that we should not go there, we should not spread there? I don't understand it. But there is the question of back contamination. This is that, say we came across life on Mars and we got infected with it and brought a plague back to Earth. It's another worry that people seem to have. But again, I don't really understand it, because the stuff that kills us has been evolving with us in lockstep in a sort of arms race. As Robert Zubrin once said, trees don't get colds and humans don't get Dutch elm disease. If there is life on Mars, it's evolved completely independently of us and is very unlikely to even be able to communicate with us on a molecular level. So I don't think this is a real concern. Sure, we need to, if we do find life there, we do need to make sure that on the off chance it is risky, that we take care of that. But it's not a showstopper. We need to put things in context. I mean, what are we talking about here? The evolution of the universe, what have the steps been? There was the Big Bang. There was the expansion of the universe and the formation of the fundamental forces. There was the war of attrition between matter and antimatter. There was the formation of hydrogen and helium atoms. Clouds of these atoms came together, formed galaxies and stars. The fusion and supernova processes created the heavier elements. These created a second generation of stars, this time with planets around them. On at least one of those planets, the advent of single-celled life came into existence. That life became complex and differentiated itself into plants and animals, life going from the oceans to the land. The Darwinian process of evolution to mammals. Life becoming conscious. The universe is now self-aware, through us at least. That consciousness engineering the world around it to its liking. I would argue that the next step in evolution on this grand scale would be life becoming multiplanetary. And as Elon Musk once said, if you can put something on that scale of evolution, then it's important. And it's worth a little bit of our resources. So why haven't we gotten to Mars? We've actually had the technologies to do it for at least a couple of decades. It's just a case of making the nuts fit the bolts. We don't really need to invent anything new. A couple of decades ago, NASA came up with a design for a manned mission to Mars costing on the order of $50 billion in today's money. $50 billion to set up the architecture around such a program, to create the launch vehicles and to launch that first mission, with each additional mission costing about $3 billion. Why hasn't this happened? I mean, putting $50 billion into context is, it's about 2 to 3 weeks worth of the US defense spending. There's been about 1,000 weeks since that mission plan was put together. What's going on? Political inertia. We are too short-sighted as a species. We're too caught up in trivial things today that are forgotten next week. Yes, there needs to be a balance between focusing on our near-term and long-term problems, but with the world spending 7 times more on cosmetic makeup than it does on its space agencies, with the US spending 10 times more on nuclear weapons than it does on space exploration, I question whether we have the right balance. Don't get me wrong. I'm confident that a manned mission to Mars will happen in the coming decades. What I'm saying is, don't assume that it will be carried by NASA or European Space Agency rockets, that those astronauts will have NASA or European Space Agency badges on their shoulders. If we in the West do not take the next step for humanity, someone else will. We've not been given any guarantees that the superpowers of the past were not given. Humanity has a right to change its colors. Thank you.